I want to thank Intel for supporting our show. Do you remember last year when we spoke about how the Intel vPro platform is built for business? Well, I'm glad to say we've kicked it up a notch. That's right, Intel is back with a new and improved version of the platform. The new Intel vPro platform lets you do more of what you want and less of what you don't. So it's better for you and for your IT teams, who really are the backbone of keeping your work from home experience easy and enjoyable. I can safely say that the new vPro platform gives you more enterprise efficiency with less constraints. Visit intel.in/morewithvPro, that's VPRO, to discover how you can get more done with less waiting. If you're listening on the IVM Podcast Android app, click the link that's visible to you now.
Welcome to All Things Policy, a daily podcast by the Takshashila Institution. We are a bunch of policy nerds based in Bengaluru, and we like bringing fresh perspectives to Indian affairs and Indian perspectives to global affairs. So grab a cup of coffee, sit back, and join us for today's chat.
Hello and welcome to this episode of All Things Policy. India first made the clarion call for Swadeshi, or Make in India, first in 1905. We repeated it again after independence and again during the 1970s. 50 years later, in 2020, we are doing it all over again, where we are calling for boycotting Chinese and other foreign goods, import substitution, Make in India, protecting domestic industries and infant industries, etc. Self-reliance was mentioned at least 17 times during one of Modi's corona addresses to the nation. This was all exacerbated, of course, by the border skirmish with China in Galwan Valley. And we've gone even more protectionist since then. To discuss all of this, I have with me Takshashila Research Fellow and rising YouTube star Pranay Kotastani. Pranay?
Hi, Anupam. Actually, your introduction sounded like a speech at the World Economic Forum in Davos.
Yeah, where, by the way, in that particular speech which Modi gave, just to, you know, put all of this in context, in 2018, Modi actually linked protectionism to terrorism, saying that both are equal threats to the global world order. But we'll come back to that later on. I want to start off with one really big question to you, Pranay. Are you vocal for local?
Yeah, I am vocal for local and global.
Okay. So,
yeah, I mean, what I am vocal for and what I will buy does not have a big bearing on what the nation state should do, right?
Yeah, exactly. So this is, I think, a very interesting time in the entire trade relations between India and China. Over the years, of course, we've been constantly bringing this up, and we've been talking about the trade deficit that India has with China, which is quite large. I mean, let's be clear about that. And also, you know, we have statistics about how much of India's imports actually come from China. And since 2018, it was about 16.4%. It's fallen since then, and then suddenly started rising again in about February this year. So, you know, there's ups and downs, but you can imagine that it's about 15%. So 15% of India's imports come from China. And to give off that 15%, you know, what are the different kind of components that India imports? Largely, it's chemical products. So that goes into the pharma industry. That's about 19.5% of all of Chinese imports. Engineering products are quite big. That's about 32%. Largely, I would imagine those go into heavy machinery, into auto components and so on. And then, of course, the big one that I think everyone relates to, which is the electronic product. So from our TVs and mobile phones to, every other aspect. And I think this was, it's been going on for quite some years. And every now and then we bring up this whole issue of boycotting Chinese goods, depending on some kind of geopolitical tension that exists. Last time, if you remember, Pranay, it was in, I think, 2017 when the entire issue of Masood Azhar came about, and we had said, we want to boycott Chinese goods, right? And now here again, in 3 years later, because of, again, a border skirmish, we're doing it all over again. Now, all of this is not to take away from the, I think, intensity of the situation of what's happening in the border. Correct, Pranay?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, none of this is to say that China shouldn't be taught a lesson for its arrogance. We should be finding out ways to teach China a lesson, but we should find out the instruments that don't hurt us in that process, right?
Yeah, I think this is one of the, right in the beginning, I think we can state this, that there are ways to hurt China and we should be exploring every single way in order to retaliate, in order to even, you know, stand up in the global community, etc. But none of those measures should end up hurting India more than it hurts China. And right now, if there is a policy which dictates boycotting or stopping imports from Chinese goods, you would end up actually hurting our citizens far more than you would hurt the Chinese economy. So just to give you an idea, about 60% of India's economy is made up of of consumption. And of that consumption, obviously, you know, a big part of it comes from imports, and China is one major source of import. So if we end up either banning Chinese imports, or if we end up increasing tariffs or import duties on Chinese goods, then we end up hurting our consumers, right? And that miracle story that we often think about or speak about, where, you know, your vegetable cart vendor has a mobile phone, and, you know, people from the poorest sections, in fact, have been suddenly introduced to this wonderful world of internet and mobile technology, etc. You will be gnawing away at those gains that India has had, right?
Absolutely, yeah. And that is going to hurt us. So, Anupam, let's discuss this in greater detail, okay? So, a lot of people would argue, and I'm trying to take out some of the arguments that have been made against or in favor of boycott Chinese goods, right? And both you and I have written on this, but let's go into some of these arguments in greater detail. So one argument is, people say that, you know, I don't want to use a Chinese mobile phone, and so I'm asking others to also not use a Chinese mobile phone. So what could be wrong in that? So what do you have to say to this particular view?
So it's interesting that you say that. Individually, I think it's about preferences and what is on top of your priority. And it's absolutely fine for every single individual in a democratic setup to have their own set of priorities and preferences. So it's the same thing, right? If you don't like your neighborhood store who might be offensive or in some way, or who doesn't speak your local language, right? And we often heard that as well. I don't want to go to the store because he's not from the same community as I am. That's absolutely fine. I mean, it's your preferences. Now, I might judge you differently, but it's still absolutely fine that you have your set of preferences, and you could go spend more and go to another store, probably buy things which are more expensive, etc. But there will be other people who do not, these things do not feature on the top of their priority list, right? They just want probably the best product for the cheapest price, and therefore they will go ahead and buy it. So similarly, if you think about the same thing at a national or international level, there could be, perfectly fine situations where people say, I do not want to buy Chinese goods, especially, let's say, I do not want to buy Ganesha made in China, or firecrackers to be used in some holy festival that has to be made in China. And that's absolutely fine. That's your individual preferences. However, trying to dictate government policies, which is going to affect a huge number of people with differing preferences, I think is problematic. Let each person have their own set of preferences and then let that play out. There is one tricky line, though. You could be an influential person who keeps saying your individual preferences online and so on, which could in turn dictate government policy. But then that, you know, we have to hold government accountable for being carried away by things like this.
Yeah, that's true, Anupam. So I think one thing is that all preferences in the age of digital media have become social, right?
Yeah.
So it's, you can have a preference. You could have not bought anything from a Chinese phone yourself, but that's not enough now, right? Everyone wants to send that message to 30 other WhatsApp groups they are also a part of, right? So it becomes, every preference sort of becomes, is manufactured socially, and it propagates socially to a large number of people. So that is the challenge. Now, as we were talking, that we are already in sort of a protectionist trend, right? Not just in India, but in the global scheme of things. So if we start, if this is our preference, and we even want our governments to take note of it, then government will aggregate these preferences in a very crude manner. And they will come out with a policy like, you know, put tariffs on a Chinese good, because you wanted it, right? Our citizens wanted it. They put so many videos on WhatsApp for all this. And when that happens, it is going to hurt a lot of poor Indians, like you said, a lot of Indian companies, small Indian companies, which also need machinery, which is imported from China or any other country. And if we put a tariff barrier on that, it's going to be really difficult. And the second point is, even if we just want to restrict this tariffs to China, it's not going to happen that way, right? You are going to have, if you do a restriction of trade to China, it might come from a third country, then you will again impose trade barriers on that third country, and eventually we will go into this overall trade regime which is very harmful to our companies and to ourselves.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. First, I think I just want to bring out this distinction here that this kind of protectionist turn is not new. It's not a direct result or a consequence or a reaction to what's happening in Galwan Valley. I mean, that could provide the kind of emotional impetus for us to, exacerbate the entire situation. But it's not really the root cause or the sudden kind of trigger, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think it has reached public imagination because of the recent incident. But in terms of government policy, it's been going on from some time, right?
Exactly. So, I mean, I can, you remember at the beginning of this podcast, we spoke about Modi in his Davos speech, who linked, saying that protectionism is as much a threat to terrorism and so on. This was in 2018. And in the same month, believe it or not, we actually raised tariffs on nearly 50 product groups, right? And it was on random things from clocks and kites to TVs and auto components. And in December, we started raising tariffs on electronic goods such as mobile phones, microwave ovens, washing machines, etc. In September 2018, that is about a couple of months later, we also had, the Union Minister, Gadkari, who spoke about that we should start developing an import substitution policy, right? Mm-hmm. And then the budget later that year in 2019, we spoke about a whole bunch of, increasing duties on electronic products and products that exactly come from China. Then we decided not to join the RCEP, because Modi's conscience wouldn't allow him to join that particular trade group. And then, in February 2020, for example, this is before, again, I just want to remind, before coronavirus hit India, we actually amended the Customs Act. And there was no, skirmish with China back then, but we amended the Customs Act, which gave the government really wide powers to ban imports of goods that may hurt the local economy. And I'm quoting it exactly as it is, which leaves it a lot, room for open interpretation. And basically, that means that, you've cleared the way for banning all sorts of imports of cheap toys, firecrackers, electronic items, anything from China. Right? So this was all 2020. I mean, this was in February 2020. So I'm just trying to say that there's a trend here. If you look at, for example, the number of safeguard duties that India has raised, or anti-dumping duties that India has raised, it's about 130 in the last year and a half. And that's the highest in the world, by the way, just after the US. And of course, US, imports, 5x or 10x more than what India does. So proportionately, it's probably the highest in the world in proportion to how much you trade. So I think we've been going on this slight protectionist trend for quite some time, because there's, if you just read or parse through the public discourse, and especially comments coming from the government machinery or opinion makers, etc., they're increasingly talking about this trade deficit with China, trade deficit with the rest of the world, and how we should, start looking inwards, etc. So that tone is going towards protectionism. And this was well before any of the current events.
And I think, Anupam, the bigger point in this is the failure of economic reasoning, that we always want reciprocity in terms of every single action that we do, right? So the idea is that we should treat other countries just like the other countries treat us, in exactly this, using the same instruments, right? So for example, we'll say we'll give treatment to foreign vendors in procurement only if those countries will do to our firms, or we'll remove custom duties or to against EU if they remove the custom duties against us. So all these are sort of things, conditions that we've put onto ourselves. But our whole aim should be that, does it make sense for us? And if it makes sense for us, if our own cost-benefit analysis is favorable, then we should go ahead, right? We should reduce our own import duties if it helps us.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And in the words of one of the greatest economists, which is Joan Robinson, which is often quoted when it comes to this reciprocity, she describes a situation where saying that, let's say the harbor or the coast of the port area of a country is extremely rocky, and therefore it's extremely expensive to dock there and then trade. In return, because you don't have that easy access, you put rocks into your own harbor line, right? Mm. And it makes no sense. You're hurting yourself just because some other country has got it bad. And for me, a lot of this import duties and tariffs is precisely like that. It's throwing rocks into your own harbor and port to make it difficult for ships to dock, right? So you don't have to have reciprocity. I think in a lot of cases, unilateral reduction in tariffs, unilateral liberalization in trade can be a great benefit to India. And especially, in the current situation. Now, it might sound like, I think a big problem in all of this is you're anthropomorphizing the country and giving it, a fragile ego of human beings and saying that, why should we do it when they don't do it, right? And it almost seems like you're conceding something when you, liberalize trade or when you reduce your duties, etc. It's not. In fact, you're helping yourself. Right? It's purely the fact that you're helping yourself. It's exactly like when you have money, right? When you have money and you want to go out and spend, it's like saying that I will not spend on my barber unless my barber spends on me, right? That will not happen. You have better purchasing power. You want a particular service. Go ahead and spend. Right? Yeah. Or putting, restrictions upon yourself saying, I will not eat I will not buy masala dosa from my local darshini unless that guy buys idli from me.
You brought up a sensitive topic, Anupam.
Sorry.
We are all under lockdown. Please don't talk about masala dosa in darshinis. I draw the line there. Okay. But returning back to less interesting things, Anupam, but tell me, what will happen if what good things will happen if we reduce trade barriers?
I think that is quite plain to see. One, I think the biggest kind of help is obviously to our consumers. And as I said, we are a consumption-led economy. So if we get goods cheaper, it's going to help, right? And on the other hand, when you put tariffs and so on, it can really feed through the inflation lines into our economy. So just purely on that fact, the fact that consumers get better choice, a larger variety of choice, and of course at better prices. I think that's the first benefit. But second, and I think a lot of people do not realize this, and we can draw examples from 100,000 instances in the world history, is that when you reduce your import tariffs, it's going to help your export economy and it's going to help your industries. Now, of course, the really inefficient firms might die out. And that's the first kind of, visible thing that people see, and that's why they get scared. But in the medium kind of run, what would happen is, once you have cheaper imports, right, and you can take, let's take up the auto industry, for example. The fact that we've made, over the years, reduced imports on auto components has made our auto industry stronger, has made our auto component industry stronger. So we import things, we add value, we shape it according to how we like and we use it. And these are two, really great success stories of India. And the reason is, especially auto components, is that we did not bother too much about tariffs on auto components. And therefore, it's a success story, right? If you reduce the tariffs on steel, it's going to help a whole bunch of industries which use steel, from construction to auto to other kind of manufacturing. If you reduce the import duties on big machinery, it's going to again, all kinds of industries which use those big machinery, that is factory, mass production, etc., is going to get benefited from it. So I think that's the second really big, obvious kind of benefit from reducing your import duties and tariffs. And you can look at what happened with US as a counterfactual, right? Trump went all out in a trade war with China, even well before all of this, right? And then what essentially happened was that because Trump, let's say, we'll take one example of steel, because Trump increased the duties on steel, especially coming from China and elsewhere, it essentially hurt the entire auto industry. right, in the US, and therefore a struggling industry, and the US auto industry was struggling, a struggling industry now got it probably its final death knell, right? So, and that doesn't make sense. Third, when you reduce your auto, when you reduce your import tariffs and your overall tariff structures, it's going to feed through your entire other industries in terms of how productive and how efficient they can be, right? Because now you're competing and your domestic firms are forced to compete with the foreign firms. And therefore, you know, the best of the lot will actually stay back and they can compete with the world economy. And then before you know it, they will start exporting as well. So that's another, you know, kind of big benefit from reducing import duties and so on. Fourth and final one, when you reduce your import duties, you will create pressures, alternative pressures in the other countries to reduce their duties as well, right? And therefore, it's beneficial. That reciprocity, by the way, is not required, but will ensue. It will result in that. It's a consequence of you doing it. So even, and we found this again, economic literature tells us over hundreds of years that even unilateral reduction in tariffs has actually resulted in reciprocity later on, right? And it's common to think of why this would happen, right? Once you reduce tariffs, you're getting cheaper goods, your industry is thriving, you're suddenly starting to do well. Then others in the other countries, the industry will start putting pressure on their government to reduce tariffs as well, because it's going to help them. Yeah. And the fifth and final point that I want to emphasize on here is having a open kind of liberalized regime will also help in all other aspects. So if you want investment to come into your economy, FDI and FIIs to come into your economy, and we're already speaking about how we want the Chinese companies moving out of China to locate in India, you actually can do that only if you have a liberal trade regime, because a lot of the companies that, for example, let's take Apple, which is situated in China and manufacturing, let's say MacBook Airs in China, is in fact doing that because it can export easily to the rest of the world. And in order to export, it also has to import a lot of, material from the rest of the world. So, you know, it's complex global value chain. So if you want to be part of that global value chain, the only way you can do that is by having a liberal trade regime. So if you want to attract investments, if you want to attract FDI, then we need to have a global, easy liberalized trade regime.
Yeah, Anupam, I mean, you made several counterintuitive points. And as you said, right, because of this anthropomorphizing, we never understand these counterintuitive points. Like imports can help exports, imports can also help an overall regime which aids investment. I think it's a lot to do with this false notion of indigenization that we are chasing, you know. And when we say indigenization, we don't know what it means. Like if we want to say indigenization, means goods produced in India only by Indians, only with Indian capital, I think that is like the days for that are long past. We can't go to our autarkic past. No country can, because the equipments that we produce in the world are so complex, right? We will have to depend on, some country will have a comparative advantage in investment, some will have a comparative advantage in raw materials and all that, right? So this false notion of very hard constraint on something called indigenization leads us to all these notions.
Yeah. Pranay, I want to turn the tables and I want to ask you something, because this is something I think a lot of people are thinking about, right? Let's say the well-merited arguments about reducing dependence on the Chinese economy doesn't come out in a vacuum. It comes from a very real feeling, probably a place of insecurity a visible kind of threat, saying what would happen, let's say in a war-like scenario, which is what is happening now, and when tension and animosity builds up, can China hurt India because of our dependence on them? Can they suddenly cut off essential supplies to India? I mean, are we that dependent on Chinese products that in order to, you know, for China to hurt India, let's say it says we will no longer export some of the items to you. And how would we go about in a situation such as that?
Yeah, that's a good point. And I think we should be at least considering this, given how China's arrogance has acted and how it has acted against so many of its neighbors. Now, in that situation, right, I think we are already prepared for it in terms of the strategic sectors, right? So that's why we say that don't let Huawei into your 5G infrastructure, right? That is a real threat. You don't want your communications infrastructure to be in the hands of your adversaries. necessary. So that makes perfect sense. And I think I would bat if someone says that don't allow Chinese or Huawei into 5G. That makes sense. And we are already doing so in most of our strategic sectors, not just against China, but we don't allow investment from many other countries in our strategic sectors, countries which are sort of adversarial to India. So that is already taken care of. Now, I don't understand if there is a war, what will China say? We'll stop exporting motors to you and we will stop exporting plastics to you, and how is that going to hurt us? We will buy it from a third country. Yes, it will be a cost game. We will have to pay higher cost because we are going to import to a third country which does not have as much of a comparative advantage as China. But in the event of a war, that will be a really small price to pay. I mean, we have much higher consequences and much higher priorities at that point of time. So we are just going to end up paying higher from some other country. And there will also be, remember, all this export to India helps Chinese players as well. So they are also going to find out ways to reduce that from China or import from a third country. So I don't think there is any such strategic good that China will stop and tomorrow Indians will be left hanging without doing, at the mercy of the Chinese that you need to export us. It's not as if we are dependent on them for food or for water or for, really strategic commodities for the nation state as well. So I think we are underestimating our own strength when we make such argument. Yeah, what do you think, Anup?
No, I agree with you in the sense that it's not that China is the sole producer of these things. It might be the cheapest, which is why we're buying from them, but it's not that it's the only country in the world which is manufacturing steel or iron or toys or electronic items. I mean, you will still be able to buy mobile phones from elsewhere. It's going to be expensive, but yeah, it is still available. And the other kind of reality around this is that the higher the Chinese investment and trade with your country, the higher that there are interests to protect this trade. And therefore, the lower the incentive to go into war and do other things. You know, if India becomes a huge importer of Chinese goods, by the way, as of now, it isn't. And we'll come to that just in a minute. And there is huge Chinese investment in your country, then you want to protect those investments. And in fact, India gets a leverage there, right? So, but as of now, that's not the case. I mean, India accounts for only about 2 to 3% or 4% at best of Chinese exports, of overall Chinese exports. So even at the worst, if you want to cut off all of that 3% or 4% and not import even a single good from the Chinese economy, you can't actually make a dent in the Chinese economy. It's not going to really hurt them by as much as you think it would. I mean, you're going to hurt yourself a lot more than you can hurt China. So I think that's, again, bitter pill to swallow and a harsh kind of dose of reality, but it's required when you make, these kind of decisions and analysis.
Right. So in this section, what we are saying is first that, they can't suddenly restrict some supplies and Indians will not be at their mercy. We are not that dependent on them. We'll just end up paying higher costs, which if we import tariffs also will be the same consequence anyways. Although, Anupam, I don't agree with you on the fact that economic interdependence will necessarily lead to a Chinese state which is more benevolent or more understanding of Indian interests. I think that is a different calculus that comes into being, and we don't know if economic interdependence even empirically leads to reduction of conflict.
We can probably leave that at the disagreement level. But if your key stakeholders in your economy is heavily dependent on another country, then, you might have an incentive to protect that relationship with the other country, is all I'm saying. Now, of course, there are limitations to how much this logic can be stretched. And of course, the question comes about whether, of course, China doesn't operate like any other democratic country where they're beholden to their voters. But nonetheless, I think to some degree and some extent, this logic still holds.
Yeah. Okay. So on that we should discuss in another episode. Now let's come to the last point, which is generally made in the context of China, boycott China goods, right? That is trade deficit. Now I have heard this many times over, Anupam, that we run a trade deficit with China, which is so many billions of dollars. So it shows that we are too dependent on them, or we are giving away a lot of money to them. And why should we strengthen our own adversary? So we should not do trade with them. So what do you have to say to that?
So there are two bits on trade deficit. And I want to, really talk about this probably as briefly as possible. But one of the reasons why you would have a trade deficit is probably because you are a big growing economy where incomes are increasing, and therefore you have the ability to purchase more, the best products from the rest of the world. According to me, that's really not a bad sign, and that's not something to get worried about. So if we are buying increasingly, from other countries, and it could be China, it could be the US, but it just signifies that you are a growing economy with increasing kind of purchasing power, right? So that trade deficits in and of itself are not bad. Again, sorry to bring my barber in, but I have a trade deficit with my barber, and I've had for the last, 20, 25 odd years. And I don't want that situation to really change, right? Mm. So in purely on that logical level, it doesn't really matter if you have a trade deficit. The other reason, and I think this is also equally valid, by the way, you could also have a trade deficit because you're not competitive enough. Right? That you are not producing enough goods that others in the world want. And in this particular case, let's say in a purely bilateral sense, you're not producing enough goods that the Chinese want. Right? And therefore, the answer to that doesn't, come down to stopping imports from China. It's about how do you become more competitive and start exporting more. And that by itself, probably it's an entirely different podcast altogether. But, the standard answers, which equally applies to what happens domestically, about how do you ensure growth and so on. It's about getting all your basics right, about the domestic reforms, structural reforms, blah, blah, blah. What every single macroeconomist has been saying for the last, 200 odd years, right? Those things all apply about how do you become more competitive. But that doesn't have anything to do with, stopping imports from other countries. That's my brief answer, by the way.
Yeah, and by the way, like even US has a trade deficit with China, right? It's not as if it has become poorer because of that. If we need to think of this trade, I think the problem is the word deficit.
Yeah.
And because it is a deficit, we always see in a very negative value. But trade deficit can actually be a source of strength, right? We can say that, you have to supply to us. We can buy from a third country, but you're not going to get as big a market as we are. So it goes both ways.
It goes both ways. So India has a surplus with the US, a trade surplus with the US, and India has a trade deficit with China. The US has trade deficit with both India and China, right? So this, you don't read too much into it, except the fact that, we are producing something that US wants, China is producing something that we want, and both India and China is producing something that the US wants, right? That's about it.
Right.
And they have the money and wherewithal to actually buy these things.
Yeah, that's true. So instead of using arguments of those nature to, block trade from these countries, we need to at least learn from what that country has done domestically so that they are able to have a comparative advantage over production, and probably try to replicate those with our own constraints, our own advantage domestically ourselves, right? That is what the lesson that we should be taking out from a trade deficit or a trade surplus.
Absolutely, Pranay.
All right. So Anupam, we'll end this episode here. So we broadly discussed the more sensible arguments that are made in favor of boycotting Chinese goods. And we tried to offer a view as to even why those arguments have their limitations and why we should think through this idea of blocking ourselves up from the world more. We should give more scrutiny to this thinking before falling prey to it.
Exactly.
Thanks.
Thank you so much.
If you liked our show, don't forget to check out other interesting podcasts on the IVM network. You can tune into them on the IVM Podcast app, ivmpodcast.com, or wherever you listen to your podcasts. You can also follow IVM on social media. The handle is @IVMPodcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. And hey, if you'd like to dive into Takshashila's research on technology, strategy, and economic affairs, check us out at our Twitter handle @TakshashilaInst or our website takshashila.org.in.
I hope you enjoyed that show. I'd like to thank our sponsors this week, Paytm Money and Intel. We appreciate their support. It's been a fantastic week on the IVM Network. I hope that you've been checking stuff out, but some of the highlights that you definitely should check out. Ashish Vidyarthi, host of Begin the Journey, was on Cyrus Says. They had a really fun conversation. I think you'll enjoy that. Uncle Please Sid did an episode around development, which was really, really fun. On Edges and Sledges, we had Adam Holyoake, former England captain. Well, those guys are killing it one cricketer after the other. Definitely do check out Advertising is Dead. We talk about esports with some really guys who really know that space. Smile India, absolutely right. These guys are killing it as well. So is Pawan at Pragati. Don't forget The Original Things. Again, one of my favorite shows. You must check that out. And thanks for listening, and we hope to catch you again next week.
Entertainment is like food for the brain. It's a window to culture and a great way to understand the world around us. The internet has changed what it means to be an entertainer, creating new storytellers with millions of fans. It has spawned a new breed, the story sellers, those behind the scenes creating the business for this ecosystem. They work with brands, platforms, and channels who are keen to capitalize on an audience hungrier than ever for more stories. I'm Vineet Kanabar, and I have a ringside view to how stories are told and sold. On my show, I bring you creators, artists, executives, and marketers for a freewheeling conversation around the business of entertainment. Tune in to Storytellers and Story Sellers for personal stories, analysis, and criticism every Thursdays as I talk to the brightest minds telling or selling great stories today.